back to the Mal Pope Show, coming to you live from Cardiff. My next guest is an institution. He's helped launch the careers of so many musicians. I hold him in the highest esteem. Will you please welcome Whispering Bob Harris? Bob, this is... It must be like old times, because the old grey whistle test, that was all live stuff
as
well.
It was, yeah. No, the routine of the day-to-day, it's been amazing. It's been like a sort of rerun for me.
Take me back when you first started, because the first job you got was at Radio 1.
Yes, it was. I arrived at Radio 1 sort of from nowhere. I'd never broadcast before. Well, I mean, I'd done one show with John Peel on Radio 2 in the old days, when he used to do a very eclectic programme called Night Ride in the middle of the night on a Wednesday night. And when we started Time Out, he invited me in to talk about it. So, but other than that, you know, I'd never been at a microphone really before.
But the
so the first programme absolutely came out of the blue.
The microphone loves that voice. I mean, everybody who's heard it today has gone, oh, wow. It's like rich milk chocolate, isn't it? Is it always been like that?
Well, no, I mean, listening to some of the earlier things, you know, I mean, as you get older, your voice tends to sort of lower in register, and I think that's probably what's happened to me. I mean, I must admit the microphone is very, very kind to my voice. It's sort of microphone-friendly voice.
You've got a great reputation because people know that you love the music. I mean, have there been times when you put a record on for the first time not knowing what the band's like and fallen in love with it and known that it's the right?
Yeah, oh, absolutely. And when it happens, I mean, it's such a great feeling. I remember, you know, hearing the first Queen album and putting it on, you know, putting the needle on the vinyl and listening to Keep Yourself Alive, you know, ding, digga-digging, I think, wow, what's this, you know? And it keeps happening. I mean, the most recent band, for me in that respect, has been Cry of Love. Their brother album, you know, there's a track that begins the album called Highway Jones, which begins on a sort of Hendrix-style feedback guitar. And then they come in and start, but you think, yeah, you know, the band really know what they're doing. It jumps out of you in 20 seconds, you know, you're hooked.
You still love it. That's the great thing about it. You're still in love with music. I called you Whispering Bob, although I tend to refer to you now as Pontardawe Bob.
Yes.
Because the family come from there. Well, the Harris is a Welsh
Harris. Yeah, my dad was born in Pontardawe, so I got very close connections here. Yeah, I used to come down to the valleys, well, every summer with my dad, you know, to visit my grandparents as well in Pontardawe, in Edward Street, in fact.
And Mary Hopkin?
Is a distant relative, because she was born in Pontardawe, and I used to see her as a sort of 6, 7, 8-year-old. You know, she and I used to be friends, and we're still in contact, Mary and I, yeah.
All right, back to the old grey whistle test, because that, I think, with the sounds of the 70s things being rerun, people now must recognise you again for all that. I mean, some great bands turned up on that, and also you went away for doing different things, didn't you? You'd go on tour in America with different bands and just sort of follow them around.
It was brilliant. I mean, you know, the programme itself used to go out 42 weeks of the year. So we used to have a 10-week break in the summer, during which time, you know, we'd all pile over to the States and, as you say, follow people around,
like
zigzag across America, sort of linking up with people. Well, I mean, you know, there are a couple of highlights. I mean, the obvious one being John Lennon and meeting up with him in New York and doing the interview there. I mean, it was... That really is the career highlight for me. You know, that was 1975, at around the time that the Rock and Roll album was coming out. And the Capricorn Picnic the following year, down in Macon, Georgia, with all the Capricorn bands, the Allman Brothers, and that was a sort of special, a major special on the series at that time. I interviewed Jimmy Carter. You know, I mean, these are experiences in your life that, you know, it's unrepeatable, really.
Why do Radio 1 keep on sacking you?
I don't know, it's happened twice
every
now.
10 years, doesn't yes. it? With Gregor's copying, up he goes, just get rid of him.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's a bit weird, isn't it?
Well, I mean, there's been a change of management at Radio 1, as we know, and a change of emphasis. I mean, the Radio 1 has shifted now back into youth, and old codgers like me, see, Mal, you know. I'm afraid that time of Radio 1 has passed. Yeah. Yes.
Well, it's been great having you with us. And,
thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bob Harris.
Thank you.
What can I say about the Bee Gees? They've been doing it for 30 years, they're multi-millionaires, but they still want to make music. I caught up with them at the Langham Hilton in London.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you, boys.
Thank you. Thanks for making the time.
Going back right to the early days, if I can, was the music always in the house? Because Mum and Dad were both musicians as well, weren't they?
Yeah, our father definitely always brought home certain records. The records that I remember specifically were things like Bing Swings While Bregman Swings.
Yeah.
That's a tough one. Dad would lock himself in the bedroom for a few days with that.
Yeah. La Traviata, La Tosca. For some reason, Dad seemed to have an ear for that kind of
music. There was one album called The Big Trouser Blues. Put
that one down. The Mills Brothers.
Yeah.
I got a guitar for my ninth Christmas. And I learned a certain way of tuning, which is called... It was called at the time Hawaiian tuning, which is open chord tuning.
As luck would have it, I have a guitar. Because this in that case, is absolutely use to you.
No use to me whatsoever.
So which way do you tune it? Is it up to E? Or
I can do it real quick if you want me to. Yeah. Okay. Let's assume that's a D, right?
Right.
Take that down. Take this down. Take this down.
All failed, you take your trousers down.
It's all coming down today. And this isn't cheating, okay. Is it?
No.
This is all right to do.
It doesn't matter what it is, does it? I mean, it's like, okay, I've just taken those top three strings down to the, now you have a chord of D. Let's have a fifth.
Great.
Right, which is already there. Yeah. So you got your fifth and you got your D. Your bottom one needs to be changed. Just take it down a whole step.
That's got a D major.
So everything's in D. So if Barry's playing that with that guitar,
sevenths.
So when you're playing that, what about you, Morris? Because you're the other guitarist.
I play conventional tuning, which is the supposed to be the proper way.
And that's the secret, is it?
Well, it's not a secret. It's actually a country tuning as well. I think Dolly Parton plays her guitar the same way. I think she learnt by ear.
It's also Hawaiian tuning.
Yeah.
Because right. All those sort of things happen. I was listening to... now, let me just make sure. Spirits Having Flown last night. I practiced it. But I know you've got a sore throat, so don't worry.
No, it's okay.
And it was... I couldn't work out all the different...
Well, here you go.
Well, this is it. I'm going to get a master class.
Well, if I can remember it. There you go. Pale and left so easily. Where the four winds blow, I go alone. I'd like to take you where my spirit flies. Can't remember now. Through the empty skies, I go alone. Never before having.
It's easy because all night I was trying to work out all these different combinations.
Yeah. But you have to have it that tune that way to do it.
To make it
and then you make the keyboard player play exactly what you're playing.
Yeah.
Use the same notes exactly. And then you've got people scratching their heads.
Yeah. Hopefully it's just their heads.
The Bee Gees. Everybody thinks it's the Brothers Gibbs. Oh, whatever.
Well, it stands for that as well.
Yeah.
But something else?
Actually, it originated in Australia when we first emigrated over there, and we had this gentleman called Bill Gates, who was a disc jockey at a local radio station called 4BH in Brisbane. There was another gentleman called Bill Good, who was a racing driver that was sort of let us play at the racetrack. And Bill Gates saw us there, and Bill Good was a friend. He came to our house, we all sat in the room talking away, and Bill Gates noticed around the room there was Barbara Gibb, Barry Gibb, Bill Good, himself.
And Eric Smith. I didn't take notice.
And he thought, I'll call him
ES.
And
he said, ESs. He had a great idea. I've got ESs. I think it'll go great. Anyway, he
wasn't very bright.
Quietly leave the room.
No, but he thought of all the initials with our mum, Barbara.
Yeah.
And the brothers Gibb, their initials, and he thought of BG.
It's too much of a coincidence.
Well, it was B dot G apostrophe S in those days.
Rise in the morning sun, I feel you touch me in the pouring rain, and the moment that you wander far from me, I want to feel you in my arms again.
Stay alive.
How Deep Is Your Love.
How Deep Is Your Love. These were songs that were to be on our new album. And Robert said, they arrived and said, look, we want you to do the music for this film. And we said, well, what does that all mean? I mean, we've never done music for films. And Robert said, well, you know, this'll work out well. We need about four songs. Do you happen to have four songs handy that we could at least listen to and see if they work? And so we played them these songs, and each one they sort of looked at each other and said,
do the trick.
They'll do.
Not sure about How Deep Is Your Love.
Some voice in the back.
Bill Oakes thought How Deep Is Your Love would be better for Yvonne Elliman, because she was his wife at the time.
It's a good idea, isn't it?
Yeah. But it seemed like the right thing. It's really about the club explosion and the dance music explosion in New York. And that's what it's about. So we saw no script. We just thought, well, okay, that's what it's based on. And that's where it went. And nobody, even including Robert, could have possibly imagined what was going
on. But you couldn't, could you? I mean, it's like the Beatles starting off. You couldn't imagine that happening.
No.
And for a while, you were popular culture, weren't you, for those years?
Well, yeah, well, all of a sudden, we became the hottest disco band around.
And suddenly, out of nowhere, Robert said, you're not going to believe this. And we said, what, Robert?
What,
Rob? He said, you're selling a million a week. And on this album, and we couldn't quite take that in, so, you know.
Life can never be the same. I mean, having number ones in Britain and America, I suppose, are fun, but after that, life can never be normal, can it?
Well, life has never been normal for us. Even long before Fever, I mean, our childhood wasn't normal. None of it had been normal. You know, we'd travelled around the world before we were teenagers, so we'd had a very bizarre lifestyle, you know. So it just sort of fitted in a way.
Was that something that happened early on as well?
That happened accidentally. It was Nights on Broadway. Arif said, we need some kind of high falsetto scream at the end of Nights on Broadway to sort of a little bit of cream on the cake. And one of you guys needs to go out and try it. Let's see if any of you can do it.
Up to then, it hadn't happened?
No. And I volunteered and they pushed me in the room. So.
You're doing well, mate.
And I tried it, and I after a few times I found out that I could do it in tune, and after that, then we did it with Fanny. We did some stuff.
Why don't I just sing this in falsetto?
Or why don't we try it in unison with real voices as the high octaves, and that started another thing off with like Fanny Be Tender and stuff like that. And then what followed then was a period of experimentation, like let's see if we can sing a whole song with this falsetto voice. So songs like Love So Right came out
of
that.
Children of the World.
Children of the World.
Should Be Dancing.
Yeah. And we started using that falsetto voice for various songs. And that led up to the Fever.
One of the great memories I have is, I'm not sure if you ever, you must have seen it, the Kenny Everett thing, when he's got the BG tablets.
Yeah.
He takes one and his clothes go and then his voice.
Brilliant.
That's okay, is it?
Oh, yes, it is.
Absolutely.
It's hysterical.
We just see that kind of thing as imitation is the greatest form of being flattened.
You've gone past that now. You're establishment. People look to you and think, you know, I mean, not that they're going to give you a gold watch for having lasted this long, but it's a bit like Cliff Richard, isn't it? You get to the stage where people just think, they're great because they've done it for so long, really.
We got this far, so it must be all right.
Yeah, yeah. No,
we're doing something right.
Right.
But why you still do it? You don't need the money, do you?
Do it because we love music.
Do it because we love it.
Period. Yeah.
The Bee Gees, really good lads. We've got to take another break now, but we're going to be back with the Almighty and Gordon Kiltrap. See you in a couple of minutes.